Hello, everybody. Welcome once again to the Domino Theory Television Program. My name, of course, is Sonny Francis, and I will be your host for this particular segment. We are going to show you some clips that we picked up from KQED, the public channel here in San Francisco, California. This is, by the way, channel 29 and 76, and we broadcast through the services of BayVac, the Bay Area Video Coalition. But anyway, we are going to show you some clips that we picked up from KQED and some other sources. Anyway, these clips deal with the Native Americans, and it seems as though when those people, or whoever those people were, that came over here and discovered this country that was occupied by some other people, they wanted to change their entire culture. Fortunately, that didn't happen, not completely anyway. This is just a small clip about a gentleman named, I think they call him General Pratt or something like that. But anyway, he's a musician, and he wanted to go out and take these Native Americans and make them play music, not with the drums and the stuff that they were using, but with instruments that were European, I guess, like horns and brass instruments. And it must have been quite a interesting project, because I'm sure that the Indians rebelled against this, but this clip shows you that they finally adjusted to it, and they found out that they could make some money with it, so they said, well, let's go with it. And then you had this Native American jazz bands and all kinds of marching bands. And, well, anyway, I'll show you the clip. It's only a brief clip, but anyway, it sheds some light on some of our historical developments here in the good old United States of America. Coming up, I think on May the 12th, somewhere around there, there will be a program at City College featuring Mr. David Hardiman Sr., the big band person, and they're going to be paying tribute to one of the professors who taught at City College for many, 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 many years. So we'll be sure to mention that to you again as we progress towards that date. We also want to say Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. And this has been a really fast year, because it looked like it was just January, and now it's already April going into May. But anyway, we are experiencing some really nice weather here in San Francisco, and we hope you are wherever you are. We understand that what is happening down in Houston, and we are certainly praying for those people who are being devastated by the floods and the waters. So we are praying for you. You are in our prayers. We'll get on with the show. I also want to feature a lady from the church that I attend, Miss Teresa Jiggins. And I hope that she doesn't get too mad with me for showing you this, but I think she has a beautiful voice and it needs to be heard. So I took the liberty of kind of filming her, and I hope she doesn't get too upset. But if you see me with a patch on my head, you'll know that she did get pretty upset about the whole thing. So anyway, we're going to show you the show. We hope you enjoy yourself. If you have anything that you want to talk to us about, you can reach us at sfdominoclub@gmail.com. Thank you very much, and we'll be back.
Okay. presidential inaugurations between the 1880s into the 19-teens. There were many, many moments in American history where these American Indian musicians were there, and they were performing the soundtrack of those kind of experiences.
It is an unusual thing to see Indians blowing the cornet and sliding the trombone. Most people think all they can do is use the tomahawk and draw reference.
But what effect does this newfound notoriety have on the students themselves? Had they, in an instant, traded their own musical traditions for something else?
What they're doing is operating in this really interesting, kind of complicated cultural terrain. Just to think, you know, what it was like to be a young person taken out of your family context and put into this new context. We should never forget how hard that was, how brutal that was, right? How unconscionable that was in so many ways. But I think when you look in the eyes of these people, you also have to remember that they were human beings. Playing music, for some of these people, was a way of sort of figuring out that kind of navigation, of having, creating an emotional life, of creating a community for themselves, of figuring out survival kinds of techniques, you know, in the middle of an oppressive kind of situation. Now, this didn't mean that this was the only kind of music that they liked. This didn't mean that Pratt's plan worked, that all of a sudden these students were only performing this quote-unquote civilized music and that they had transformed into something that they were not before. What it meant was that simply they enjoyed this kind of additional instruction because they made what they wanted to with it.
And for some, graduation day is not the end of their musical careers.
Well, once the students left the schools, they would form their own bands. And in fact, this instruction in brass band music prompted this new tradition that erupted on reservations across the country.
They learned that playing music was a vehicle and a tool that they could use now to their advantage. This now was able to change attitudes, change stereotypes, and offer to non-natives a very different picture of how to see and even view Indians in a very different light.
Graduates of the schools formed dozens of all-Indian bands using their native identity as their calling card.
On the one hand, they're demonstrating that Pratt's boarding schools were, on many counts, a total failure in terms of this plan to assimilate, to detribalize students. On the other hand, these musicians were very smart, and you know, many of them also realized that we could probably make a lot of money if we performed these pieces by Sousa wearing headdresses of buckskin. And they did. And then they've got the Great Plains headdress, right, which is the signifier of Indianness. In order to be recognized, to be visible, to be legible as an Indian, putting on the headdress in the early 20th century is the absolute way to do it. These are people who understood, you know, the power of marketing and of marketing themselves in a certain way.
I believe that those elders became very aware that this had started to become very good and fun. It became not a chore, but I think it became a labor of love.
From brass band leagues come jazz bands, chamber groups, and even corporate representatives, like the Santa Fe Railway Indian Band. The growing recognition of Indians as talented musicians challenges more nostalgic depictions of Indian culture.
It's really interesting to contrast these bands with Wild West shows. But Wild West shows are performances of narratives that everybody knows. The Indians are attacking the cabin. The Indians are attacking George Custer. The Wild West show allows Indians to be placed in narratives of the past. A band performance places Indians right in the heart of modernity.
They developed it a remarkable way, I think, of perceiving what the new economy was and where they would be allowed to be Indian and enjoy it. They found these American ways these cultural ways of turning the mirror back to Anglo-American culture and saying, okay, this, we got it.
And I think that's really a value as our culture changes, being able to express from a traditional perspective or express from a contemporary expression about being in the world. And utilizing all of those skills together, you know, is quite important.
I think this is kind of the piece of this 20th century, early 20th century moment that we don't really capture very often, is the exuberance of Indian people, the possibilities for them, not only in their home communities, right, but out there in the world, sort of enjoying, adventuring, suffering hard times, yes, but also fearless in a lot of ways. These are Indian people who have courage and joy, you know, as they're out moving in the world.
Today, most of the original bands are gone. However, four bands remain to carry the tradition forward. In addition to the Fort Mojave Band, the award-winning Zuni Pueblo Band from New Mexico plays at local, state, and national events with their distinctive style and dress. The multi-generational Navajo Nation Band is enjoyed by hundreds of festival goers every summer and has marched in three United States presidential inaugurations. And in upstate New York, the Iroquois Indian Band is a community favorite. Their membership is open to anyone of Tuscarora, Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Mohawk, or Oneida descent.
We welcome you here to the Tuscarora Indian Nation Picnic and Field Day. We are the Iroquois Indian Band. What we're going to do right now, we're going to play for you the Liberty Bound March. My name is Jeremy Printa. I've been playing with the Iroquois band for probably 13 or 14 years. I can't sit still when I listen to John Philip Sousa. I usually get off, start moving around and start. I've been like that since I was young. I make espresso and sell coffee and pastries in the lobby of a hospital. I sing and goof around and laugh and tell goofy stories most of the day. Getting to hang out with a good group of guys and gals is part of the fun of being in the band, and along with the music. Okay, everybody have Washington Post?
Okay.
One?
Oh.
The old Iroquois Indian Marching Band was under the direction of my great-grandfather, Chief Elton Green.
Unlike other bands, Chief Green's band was not made up of former boarding school students. The group was formed in the early 1900s by musicians who simply shared a love of music. Got together and they got some money, and somebody got a trumpet, and somebody else got something else, and we started gathering people up, because back then, if you wanted to listen to music, you had to play it. And there was no tape recorders or CDs or records or radios or television back then, so music was a big thing for every community to have some kind of band.
They had a lot of chops back then. they had maybe 27 players in their band at different times. My great-great uncles would be playing the trombones or playing the basses or playing the trumpets and playing the drums and playing with fury, con fuoco, with fire, and I often think of that when our band is up there on stage.
If I can find that thing, there it is.
Chief Green's memory continues to inspire his great grandson. But a rich history and home movies are not the only treasures the original band left behind.
This music is the old music that the old Iroquois Indian band used to play for violin. You don't have violins. Viola, don't have violas either. There's a lot of good stuff in here.
Although the instruments have changed over the years, the band continues to perform songs with meaning for their community.
You don't need an interpreter to listen to good music. Good music doesn't matter what race or nationality you are, it is good music. The band, you know, the people up there on the stage, they're somebody's brother, cousin, aunt. And it gives me a great pride to see somebody else doing something good as an American Indian. Just lets other people know that there's more to an Indian than feathers and furs and things like that.
In Needles, California, members of the Fort Mojave Band are orchestrating a revolution in brass music.
We started in 1906, so we've got over 100 years of music, military band style music, and even further now, that our generation has used our traditional and cultural music, as we call referred to as bird songs, arranged and transposed from gourds and rattles to brass music now. We now have bird songs that we play for our own selves that we don't have to use our conqueror's music anymore, that we're pioneering our own music with brass instruments.
It's just a heart thing, from the heart. Our way of telling our history, and so we're just doing it in a different channel through our brass music. And so that's why it's so groundbreaking. And I'm really honored and proud to be part of it. Really am.
We will still, of course, play the major standard, the national anthem, because not only are we Mojave, but we are Americans. We're proud to be Americans. And we will never completely wipe out this type of music, marching band music, military style music, because this is it, our foundation, and it's embedded in how this band has become to be and its establishment. We have to include this, but we can also be pioneers in our own music.
Birding schools to bird songs. The story of Native bands is a celebration of music, but also of Indian resilience, empowerment, and tradition.
Indian marching bands will be around because of their internal audiences, that is to say the bands themselves. People get together to play music. It just happens. It's a great thing.
It's a way for young people to identify with being traditional and modern at the same time. It's our own way to deal with how to be in the world and not lose yourself.
So we put him in under her, and then I could settle down and watch the game. April 15th, 1947, was opening day. 26,623 people, 6,000 less than capacity, turned out to see the Brooklyn Dodgers face the Boston Braves at Ebbets Field. Playing first base for the Dodgers was number 42, Jackie Robinson.
I sat behind the visitor's dugout, and I was so proud in watching Jackie. And there were a lot of black people there to see Jackie that day. They watched and they enjoyed, and they worshiped him. They worshiped Jackie Robinson, as did I.
The pitcher that day was Johnny Sane, a 24-game winner who had a mean curveball, and the test of a major league is hitting that curveball. Well, Jackie didn't get a hit, but he never struck out. I was convinced, and I think a lot of other people were convinced, this guy can play the game.
Batting second, Robinson drew a walk, reached on an error, and scored a run. At first base, he handled each chance flawlessly. The Dodgers won 5-3. For the black press, Jackie's arrival was a landmark event. But in other papers, the importance of the day went unrecognized.
Some papers did not even mention that he was a Negro. Certainly he was not the lead story. The lead story was the Dodgers were playing the Braves, and one team was going to win and one team was going to lose. In retrospect, it seems a huge milestone.
For Jack to have arrived, been able to play, there was a certain sense that there's change possible in America. And we got it from the press and from the fans and from even opposing players. So it had some real significance, and we're still celebrating it to this very day.
The strike never materialized. No Major League Baseball player would ever refuse to take the field against the integrated Brooklyn Dodgers. Robinson's first week passed without incident. In a loss to the Giants at the Polo Grounds, Jackie scored twice and hit his first big league home run. But when the Philadelphia Phillies came to Ebbets Field, their manager, Ben Chapman, a sharp-tongued Alabaman known for his ruthless bench jockeying, did his best to upset Robinson.
When Jackie came to bat, he just said, "Hey boy, I need a shine. Come shine my shoes. Hey boy, how come you ain't picking cotton? Hey boy, come over and let me rub your head for good luck."
For one wild and rage-crazed minute, I thought, to hell with Mr. Ricky's noble experiment. It's clear it won't succeed. I thought what a glorious cleansing thing it would be to let go. To hell with the image of the patient black freak. I could throw down my bat, stride over to that Phillies dugout, grab one of those white sons of bitches, and smash his teeth in with my despised black fist.
He didn't.
Here we were, with these questions seething in America. The country was aflame with these issues of race. This guy steps into this space, asking us to see him not only as equal, but as superior. Nah, 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 nah. Let's nigger him to death. We'll challenge his humanity. We'll challenge his sense of manhood. Nothing shall be withheld. And for him to resist that and to do what he did was in itself his own miracle.
Robinson faced everything Ricky said he would. Pitchers threw at his head. More than once, runners sprinting towards first base spiked Robinson with their cleats. And a hard slide by Robinson would not go unnoticed by opposing infielders. Before Brooklyn played Ben Chapman's Phillies in Philadelphia, Branch Rickey received a call from the president of the team. "Don't bring the nigger here," he said. "We're just not ready for that sort of thing yet."
And Rickey said, "Well, he's a member in good standing of the National League, and if you don't want to play us, we'll accept the forfeit of a game."
You thought of Philadelphia as the city of brotherly love, but yet when you went to Philadelphia, you couldn't stay in the same hotel. You had to find your own accommodations. And then there was Ben Chapman and some of the other Phillies who were vicious and uncalled for.
During one game, Cubs shortstop Len Marullo kicks Jackie as they untangled themselves after a close play at second. As the Brooklyn bench shouted at Marullo, Jackie angrily picked himself up, but didn't strike back. In the face of each provocation, he controlled his temper.
The black papers were saying that if this works, we can integrate the military next. If this works, we can integrate more colleges next. Robinson was a trial balloon, and everybody was watching.
Jackie was not uncertain about his skills. He was not uncertain about his ability. He didn't suffer fools gladly, and he did not take indignity with a smile. For him to agree with Rickey that he would endure whatever was thrown at him ate him alive.
Away from the field, Jackie spent little time with his teammates. On the road, he still had to stay at Jim Crow hotels and took his meals alone. Jimmy Cannon, writing in the New York Post, called Jackie the loneliest man I've ever seen in sports.
"I went to every home game. My presence at the game meant not just support, but it meant I saw everything that happened. I was a witness. And so he could say, 'Did you see that? Did you see that? And how did you feel?' And I'd ask him, 'How did he feel?' You know, that kind of thing. So when we got home, we didn't talk about the game. He wanted home to be a haven as much as I did, and a place where we could enjoy ourselves and we could be in love and rest from the outside, from the fight. The fight was outside. It wasn't in our house. And he didn't. Neither of us wanted to bring it in there."
The pressure, hate mail, and threats took their toll. Through April, he struggled to get his batting average above .225. Though Robinson was playing every day, he feared being benched or demoted. Then on May 9th, in a show of faith, Branch Rickey sold Brooklyn's other first baseman to the Philadelphia Phillies. That night, Jackie singled, doubled, and drove in two runs. By the middle of June, his average reached 300.
"One way of fighting back is to do well. You know, shut them up by hitting and not having tears in your eyes and pain in your heart, but, you know, playing well. And that was his one way of fighting back, was to do well and to have his team win. And they did win. They won a lot of games."
It took black baseball to the major leagues. See, at the time, baseball was a base-to-base thing. You hit the ball, you wait on first base till somebody hit it again. See, but in our baseball, you got on base. If you walked, you stole second. You try to steal, they bunch you over to third, and you actually scored runs without a hit. This was our baseball.
The steal, the sacrifice, the daring base running, the steal of home, things that had not been seen to any great effect in Major League Baseball for two decades, were back. And when you combine speed with power, you have the beginning of the modern game.
Everybody else just took their lead off the base. Jackie made it theater. You couldn't take your eyes off him. And neither could the pitcher.
And he had what I call quick speed. That's why he's a good base stealer. He'd take two steps and he was full speed.
He was not only fast, but he was wise and he knew when to steal. He knew when to take the extra base. Stealing home demands perfect timing. You can't go a second too late or a second too early. And he could do it.
Jackie's nimble. Jackie's quick. Jackie's making the turnstiles click, wrote Wendell Smith. Across the league, fans began turning out in record numbers to see Robinson and the Dodgers. Half of the 27,000 fans filling Crosley Field to see Jackie's first game in Cincinnati were black, many having made long trips by bus or train to cheer on Brooklyn's first baseman.
All these people coming from Memphis, black people, coming from Little Rock on the fried chicken specials, sleeping on benches outside the train station, sleeping on the ground. They love the Dodgers and Jackie Robinson.
The score seemed almost incidental. What did Jackie do? If ever the owners thought that it would hurt attendance, they were dead wrong.
For Robinson's Chicago debut, 46,572 fans had jammed Wrigley Field, while another 20,000 milled about outside, unable to find a ticket. It was the largest paid crowd ever to see a Cubs game at Wrigley. And in Brooklyn, ecstatic fans from across the borough embraced their new hero.
We had arrived. Everybody felt better, breathed deeper, walked taller, stepped, as the expression goes, a little bit more glide in their stride and dip in their hip. Because Jackie Robinson had come to baseball. I was the firstborn hearing child of two deaf parents. And the subject they were talking about was I had to spell Jackie Robinson. Black player baseball. Who, what? Because this player was different. He was black, and he was going to be treated differently, not just as a baseball player. From then on, my father was hooked. Jackie Robinson was his subject.
And Jackie Robinson,
he would ask me to explain what was going on the radio. And I would sign furiously. Of course, I couldn't keep up with Red Barber, and certainly I couldn't duplicate his accent.
Ball game in this series, just as tight as a brand new pair of shoes on a rainy day.
By the end of June, strong hitting by Bruce Edwards, Carl Furillo, and Jackie Robinson, and dominant pitching by Ralph Branca propelled Brooklyn to first place in the National League.
Robinson is making all of them look good. Their batting averages go up, they're driving in more runs. Then you start to see a transformation. Even Dixie Walker, who was the most violently opposed to this experiment, even Dixie Walker begins to give him batting tips. It's not because he's lost his racist instincts. It's because he wants to win.
I used to get the Brooklyn Dodgers game on the radio. And they referred to him as the Bums. And that sort of struck a chord with me because he, like our status, blacks in America, was low too. We looked upon Jackie as someone bringing hope. The things is going to get better. This was the beginning of a change.
I grew up in the Great Plains, out on the prairie in a succession of small towns. And my dad was the last of 10 children. He had a very, very difficult childhood. And I don't think that he was ever recognized for all the skills that he had. And so he identified with people who seemed to be discriminated against, or in fact were discriminated against. It certainly was a family decision that once they heard that the Dodgers had signed a Negro, the first ever to play in the major leagues, there was a family consensus that we would be for the Dodgers. And from that moment on, we lived and died Dodger blue. And for me, there was no larger figure in my life than Jackie Robinson.
When Jackie came in, he could do everything. He could run, he could hit. He was very special. Boy, I said to myself, I got a chance. If Jackie can make it, I have a chance to get to the majors.
On July 5th, the Cleveland Indians of the American League signed Larry Doby, a 26-year-old outfielder for the New York Eagles. He had been leading the Negro National League with a .458 batting average. That season, Doby mostly sat on the bench, appearing only occasionally as a pinch hitter. But his presence signaled that blacks were in the major leagues, both leagues, to stay.
Well, a first really is no good unless there's a second. To the extent that the first can open a door, and then that second creates a trend, those doors can't be permitted to even appear to shut or to close. The foot first.
Pee Wee Reese, who grew up in Kentucky, and then Robinson was taking horrible, horrible abuse there from the fans, people calling him nigger, shouting death threats, and that in the middle of this shower of abuse, Pee Wee Reese stepped across the field, dramatically put his arm around Jackie Robinson, and sent this message to the fans and to his own teammates and the opposing team that Robinson was one of us. And today it's remembered in statues, in children's books, but I don't think it happened.
We don't know that this ever happened. We don't know when it happened. It is likely that if it happened, it didn't happen in 1947 because Reese would have had to have traipsed across the diamond to first base to throw his arm around Jackie. And even if there were evidence for it, how much are we to congratulate a person for behaving properly?
There was no mention of the gesture that year in either the white or black press.
When they decided to make a statue of Jack and Pee Wee with his arm on Jack's shoulder, I asked them not to do it and told them I had a better picture that I would like them to make a statue of the two of them. When they were coming off the field and their hands touched, and I thought, this is the way we want to present that relationship between that black man and that white man, as partners. And no one would buy it.
We want to feel like white people have something to do with this, that we were open-minded, that we saw what was right, and we wanted to make it happen. And Pee Wee Reese is our symbol for that. We all want to be the one who's wise enough to see that we can do better as a country. So that the myth serves a really nice purpose. Unfortunately, it's a myth.
As the 1947 season stretched into mid-August, the Dodgers held a slim lead over the St. Louis Cardinals for first place in the National League. With St. Louis due at Ebbets Field for a critical three-game series, a 17-year-old die-hard Cardinals fan from Richmond, Virginia, named Doug Wilder, was invited to drive all the way north to Brooklyn to see his first Major League game.
The barbershop was my forum. And the guys who ran the barbershop, they loved for me to come in and bring my encyclopedia. They liked for me to run my mouth and talk and challenge others. And they would tell the others, shut up, listen to the kid. And so when hearing about Jackie Robinson finally playing for the Dodgers, they came and knocked on my door and said, you think you want to go to the ball game tomorrow? And I said, wow. They had bought a brand new Buick, and they fitted me in the back. And they were not going to see the Cardinals like me. They were going to see Jackie.
That same summer, Louis Uhlberg had come home with a surprise for his son. Though Myron followed the Dodgers religiously, like most boys from his neighborhood, he had never seen them in person. As
secure two tickets for a game at Ebbets Field against the rival Cardinals.
I was pretty excited about getting those tickets, and I could hardly sleep the whole week prior to the game. As you get off the subway, you have to walk a couple of blocks, and you turn a corner, and there's Ebbets Field. And then we went into the anteroom. I remember these wooden turnstiles and this huge chandelier with baseball bats and baseballs on it. To me, it looked like a countryside, all green, beautifully manicured. The whole thing was absolutely overwhelming.
The place was packed.
Ebbets Field in Brooklyn was filled up. Rabbit fans screaming and hollering, "Hit the ball, Jackie boy, come on, Jackie, come on."
My father had gotten seats in a box seats along the first base line because Jackie Robinson was playing first base.
We had great seats on the first base line, and I didn't appreciate how great the seats were until later.
My father had no interest in the game. With laser intensity, he was focused on Jackie Robinson.
They threw the ball to Jackie, and he stretched his foot, and Slaughter came and spiked him right across the Achilles tendon. The fans, they let it be known that Jackie was theirs. And you've heard one of them. We're not gonna put up with it.
The fans were screaming, "Jackie, Jackie, Jackie," and my father was screaming, "Aje, Aje," in his deaf, guttural voice. The fans stopped looking at Jackie Robinson in the field and started looking at who was this screaming in this strained voice. And I was just totally, totally embarrassed. My father saw that. He saw that and he called me on it. Often, when my father came home, he was angry. I always thought maybe this is something that happened to him on the subway. Some slight. Somebody pushed him. Somebody made a face or even verbally cursed him. I came to understand how we saw Jackie Robinson as a brethren, as someone who experienced what he experienced in life, as someone who has to live a life different, made to feel different. And the same with Jackie Robinson.
That first game that I saw, there wasn't any question in this instance that something has changed here. It was more than just an athletic contest. It was a spirit, a birth of a new spirit in America.
Brooklyn took 2 out of 4 from St. Louis to maintain their lead over the Cardinals. With 5 games to go, the Dodgers clinched the National League pennant. Thousands turned out at Brooklyn's Borough Hall to celebrate. The next day was Jackie Robinson Day at Ebbets Field. Robinson's play had drawn more fans to the small ballpark than in any season since it had opened in 1913. Jackie's mother, Mally, traveled east to attend the festivities. Bill Bojangles Robinson, the great tap dancer, presented Jackie and Rachel with gifts, including cash, a watch, a television set, and a brand new Cadillac. He praised Jackie, saying, "I'm 69 years old, and I never thought I'd live to see the day when I'd stand face to face with Ty Cobb in Technicolor." Time magazine put Jackie on its cover that same week. And when the season ended, the Sporting News, which had once argued against integration and predicted Jackie's failure, named him the first ever Rookie of the Year. Jackie finished the regular season with a .297 batting average, led the Dodgers in home runs, doubles, runs scored, bunts for base hits, and total bases, and led the National League in steals with 28. Even Dixie Walker praised him. Robinson had done as much as any other player to put the Dodgers up in the race, Walker said. He is everything Branch Rickey said he was.
It's in the porch. The match, you're swinging. It's a whistling high drive.
But in
World Series, the Dodgers lost in 7 games to the New York Yankees. Jackie Robinson was now the most famous and admired black man in the country. Voters in a radio poll ranked him second only to Bing Crosby as the most popular American. He finished ahead of Frank Sinatra, Eleanor Roosevelt, and General Dwight Eisenhower. But in the years ahead, Robinson would risk his place in baseball and his immense popularity to speak out again and again against the injustice he saw nearly everywhere.
There's always going to be a price to pay for any rebel sound that challenges oppression. Have you shown anything that suggested dignity and the sense that you believed in equality, you were immediately undesirable. Be a good nigger.
He couldn't continue to be silent and to be subordinate. He had to be himself, and he had to represent the race as well as himself.
As long as I appeared to ignore insult and injury, I was a martyred hero. But the minute I began to argue, the minute I began to sound off, I became a swellhead, a wise guy, an uppity nigger. When a white player did it, he had spirit. When a black player did it, he was ungrateful. I was a fine guy until I began to change. Jackie Robinson.
Place is empty. No more traffic in streets. All the builders too were silent. No more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the boardroom there's no debate. Work on earth is all suspended. As the
thank you. Well, we hope that you have enjoyed the show. We certainly have enjoyed bringing it to you. And as I said before, we have been doing this for a while now, and we really enjoy bringing things to you that may enlighten you as to stuff that goes on around you. So, and I don't want to say stuff, but things that go on around you. And you can be sure that we'll be here as long as we are welcome. So with that said, we would like to invite you back for another Domino Theory program. Once again, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers and to my mother, Mrs. William A. Ware. In Kendall, Louisiana, we hope that she has a wonderful Mother's Day. And we also hope that all of you mothers have a joyous Mother's Day, and that you and your children are happy, and that everything is okay. So once again, sfdominoclub@gmail.com. You can reach us if you have any suggestions or any questions or anything that you want to talk about. I showed you the film clip of Jackie Robinson. And the reason I showed you that is because Jackie Robinson was actually the first African-American to enter into Major League anything. And I think that was quite a feat. And the stuff that he had to go through was just incredible. But he did it, and because he did it, you see all of these people out here now playing Major League Baseball, playing Major National Football, NBA. And we should all really be cognizant and realize that we didn't just do this by ourselves. We are standing on the shoulders of those who came before us. And my thanks to Jackie Robinson and his wife. As you saw in the clip, she shares with us some of the adventures, or I should say some of the trauma that was heaped upon them. Just because he wanted to be a baseball player. But anyway, our hats off to Jack Robinson, number 42. They just said a thing, I think, where everybody wore, there was a game and everybody wore the number 42 to commemorate the great Jackie Robinson. So, with that said, may God bless you, take care of yourself, and we hope to see you again soon, as is humanly possible. Take care.